Hello friends and welcome to this episode. My name is Glenn Coco and I make role-playing games for a living. The goal for this episode is to try and complete what we started the last episode. We are trying to make a role-playing adventure from scratch. If you haven't watched the last episode, I advise you to do that, otherwise you will be quite confused on what we're doing here. So let's not waste any more time and let us create an adventure together. Roll the intro. If you like this kind of content, you should really consider to hit the like button and subscribe to this channel. It will help this channel tremendously and you will join the ever-growing community of narrative role players out there. And as a special offer, if you hit the subscribe button within 30 seconds, King Charles Gustav the 16th of his name, King of Sweden, will bless you with the gift of storytelling, and he should know since his family invented role-playing with a little game called The Witch Trials. Back to the video. Okay, let's get to work. So the characters are standing there in Alice's house, and they are scared because they are hunted by the entire town and they are alone, and now they're apparently unable to defend themselves. No, they're not unable to defend themselves. Of course they can use a defensive role, but they cannot use violence to hurt someone. That's the premise of the story. So I think that the characters need help to understand what happened to them. Think about Alice's place. I think she lives in a rather small place, only a bedroom and a living room that's combined with the kitchen, I think. And well, she needs a workspace of some sort because it's there where she conducts her experiments. So in her workspace, she will have some research notes. So like years worth of research notes, and it describes the effect of the potion. And oh yeah, the characters now have a brief window of opportunity where they can revoke the effect of the potion. Otherwise it will become permanent. And she will also note that there is antidote to her poison. That's the only downside to her poison. She writes this. There is a fungus. No, she doesn't know that. Yeah, she knows that. And she writes that it grows on the northern part of the island in the... And it's cut off because she has torn away that part of the page. Now the characters know that they need to stay on the island for a bit longer. Otherwise, they will stay like this forever. And I don't think they want that. Okay. So the characters will also be kind of confused why Alice did this to them. So in her bedside table, is it called? Bedside table, there is a journal describing her reason for the... conducting this experiment, also her plans on what she's planning to do. She is heading to the military camp and try to enlist as she's enlisting as a chef or a healer. And there at the military camp, her plan is to poison every recruit and officer and to make the entire island unable to defend herself when imminent war is coming. Now the characters know what has happened to them and why. That's good, right? Now the adventure starts. So say that they have, and this is surely noted in her research notes, that they have 48 hours until the poison is permanent. Yeah, 48 hours, I think that's sufficient it's enough time to stay on your toes and feel a bit anxious, but enough time so they will be able to complete their adventure. So it's time for the characters to get the hell out of town, that's for sure. And if the characters have all their belongings with them, that's good. I don't think they have though, because remember, just a couple of hours ago they were either fighting at the arena, so they probably didn't bring their entire luggage with them to the arena, or they were arrested and sitting in the town jail. So their equipment would probably be at an inn somewhere. So let's backtrack a bit and invent two inns for this town. The town of Ironwick. Let's make a cheap one and a more exclusive one. Okay, so the cheap one is called Hold Your Thought. Use my good Scottish accent. Hold Your Thought, it's called. And it's run by old lady called Lydia Earwig. Lydia Earwig, she's senile, so she doesn't really know that the players stayed there, if they did. It's a one-story building with a pub and a dormitory, so it's a really shabby place. And they don't have any security or whatnot. If they come by during the day, there won't be any locals there. Because, well, maybe it's just one or two town drunks that are regulars. Two regulars there, that's always there. That's like they're part of the interior. So if the characters stayed at that place, they won't have any trouble to get their equipment back from there. But yeah, the only trouble they will have is to sneak to that place without being seen. So the more exclusive inn is called what's a fine establishment name? Rosebud. Isn't that the sheet for getting a lot of money in The Sims? I think so. Rosebud. And it's run by the Rosebud family. It's a family of four. So we have Mama Rosebud, Papa Rosebud, and we got the son, who's a deadbeat, the bum, he's called Willie Rosebud, and then we have Claudia Rosebud, who's the youngest flower of them all, of the bunch. Mama Rosebud is the matriarch, Papa, he runs the kitchen. Willa Rosebud is supposed to tend the rooms at that place, but he mostly hides from work. And let's say that Claudia, yeah, she had a growth spurt when she was 12, and now when she is 13, she is as broad across the shoulders as any of the characters. So her job is to be the security, the bouncer. Yeah, a job she's really, really enjoying. So Rosebud's is a three-story building with the dining hall and the pub at the ground floor, and the second and third floor will be the rooms. So they will have a dormitory, and the rest of the rooms will be rooms with two beds. So getting their stuff out from that place will be significantly harder than from the sheep place. If the characters want help from any of the Rosebuds, I think their safest bet will be to ask Mama or Willie Rosebud, because Papa Rosebud, he will immediately call the town guards, and well, Claudia, she will take care of the business herself. I think she will gladly pride her area, her workspace, with the heads of the PCs if she gets the chance. So watch out for her. Okay, so the characters have their stuff now, hopefully, or they decided that it's not worth it. It's not worth the struggle. So now they need to escape town without being seen. Here, in my experience, I think that it's more fun for the players if they get to plan their escape by themselves. Like, the planning is the most fun part of the escape. Like in a heist, if you ever run a heist before, the planning phase is more fun than the execution phase. Well, it's equally fun, but I don't think that you as a narrator or GM, whatever you want to call yourself, that you don't need to figure stuff out yourself. You shouldn't plan the heist in a heist adventure. You should let the players do that. Let's just say that there is a lot of ways to get out of town. There will always be carts that's moving in and out of the town through the city gates. There will also be boats in the docks where the players can steal a boat and sail around the coast and get out of the city that way. And I think also that the arena will be unattended when there isn't a gladiatorial game running. It's really important that you make clear to the players that if they escape the island without finding the antidote, they will stay like this forever. So their objective isn't to find Alice and to kill her. Their objective is to go to the northern part of the island to find the antidote. So let's say that the northern part of the island is a forest, or at least that the forests make out most of the northern part, and it will take them half a day's journey to reach that forest. And between the forest and the town, there will be a bog. To infuse a bit of urgency in the journey, let's say that whenever they rest or stop for any reason, the person with the lowest modifier for luck, he or she gets to roll, and if that roll is failed, they will encounter bounty hunters. That's basically a group of townsfolks that wants to capture the characters and drag them into town to claim their bounty, because there will be a bounty on their heads. Okay, so when they travel through the bog, let's call it the Moonlight Bog, the characters will need to forage or hunt to be able to feed themselves now when they don't have their luggage with them. So let's make some traveling encounters. You can use the ones that are in the core rule book, but as usual, I think it's more fun if we make targeted encounters, so we know what we will get. Doesn't it bother you that I don't have anything on this side of the desk? Shouldn't I have anything here? I think it's empty. It looks kind of empty, doesn't it? Hopefully it looks better, but what do I know about Feng Shui? Let's just make four encounters that you can roll for randomly. You can just skip the encounters altogether and tell the players that they reached the northern part of the island if you don't fancy traveling encounters. The first one, let's make it easier for ourselves. Let them encounter bounty hunters. So let's go to the second encounter. Let's say that they will meet a traveling merchant and her husband, and they have a wagon, and that wagon is broken. It's just broken down in the swamp, in the bog. They ask the players for help to fix the wagon. It's a classic one, but here's the thing. Depending on if the players have their luggage or not, maybe their moral compass is somewhat skewed. So there is a possibility that they might rob these totally defenseless persons. In their wagon, they have rations of food, water, and weapons. It's a weaponsmith that's late to the festival in Ironwick. Let's say that if they help the merchant, The merchant would just say thank you and be on her way to the festival. They won't get any reward, just to mess with their heads a bit. The third one, let's say that they come to a place with waist-deep water. So it's a watery area separated by small islands that maybe three persons can stand on at the same time. We need to come up with something dangerous to encounter in the water. Some animal or some monster of sort. Ooh, a couple of months ago, I dreamt of a creature that was, it had the body of an eel, but the head of a hippopotamus. I think it would be suitable to put that animal or monster or whatever you would call it in the water. Say that it is an electric animal. Call it Eelopotamus. So there is a lot of Eelopotami in the water. So the characters need to jump from island to island to avoid being electrocuted. Being electrocuted will of course make the characters spasm out, and he or she will be at risk of drowning. So it could be a really exciting encounter. The fourth one, I don't want to make just a standard combat encounter because they can't fight. Let's say that they come across a deserted town, like a town with huts. There will be a hand-painted sign outside the town where someone has written their name, like Glenstown. And his name would be Ladius. Ladius Town. Who is Ladius and why is the town deserted? Let's say that 6 years ago, the townsfolk were wiped out by a strange illness, and that Ladius is the only person still alive. But he has become mad and he still believes that the people are still there alive. So the characters will hear a person arguing in the biggest hut, let's say the town hall hut. So if the characters enter the town hall hut, they will meet Ladius, deranged man with long beard, and he will have he will conduct the town meeting with all of the bones of the of the townsfolk, and he wants to propose a vote for introducing a capital punishment for loitering. If the PCs make fun of him in any way, he will say like, well, I expected as much from loiters as yourself. And he will yell to the bones of the town guard that she will seize the characters. And what do you know? When he does, the bones of the town guard assembles into a skeleton that wants to fight the characters. There you go. Four random encounters. Okay, so their journey is over. They have traveled for half a day, or maybe you had a traveling montage. Doesn't matter. They will reach the tree line of the northern forest, and that is called a northbound growth. And that's a thick, luscious forest filled with fir and pine tree. And when they enter the forest, they will hear a tiny commotion, like a tiny noise of struggle. And they hear that from behind a shrubbery. And when they peek out, they will see a twig. Yeah, a 30 centimeter, that's 10 inches long twig, or a branch, or a stick with arms and legs and a gnarly nose and googly eyes. And he or she or it, for the sake of it, just say he is getting his ass kicked out of two brightly colored knee-high toads or frogs. He will cry out for help and he will look really defenseless. And if the characters intervene, the toads will just run off somewhere. They are really afraid all of the big humans that enter the scene. But if they don't, they will break the stick in half. But that doesn't do anything, because sticks doesn't have internal organs. Or at least I don't think they do. No? Stick people doesn't have internal organs. Let's call the stick people the Twiggies. When they broke that poor Twiggy in half, the toads will riddle, they're done with him, and they will run off. But the Twiggy has just, he's just pretending to be dead. When the coast is clear, he will start to cry for help again. Depending on whether or not the players intervene or not, it doesn't matter. The Twig will ask them to bring him to his town, the town of Twiggleton. He will say that it's close by, up in the trees somewhere, and if they do, the players will be rewarded. And if that doesn't win the pieces over, he will say that the town has a druid who is really talented in potion making. That will probably win them over. Twiggleton, it's gonna be a fever dream or like a child's imagination of the ultimate jungle gym or treehouse combined. So it will have like slides, zip lines, and rickety rope bridges that leads to plateaus, wooden plateaus in different levels, and the Twiggies, they live in cavities in the trees. But most of the day they walk outside and live on the plateaus as a community of sticks. So when the characters climb on top of any of the plateaus, it will be a commotion of Twiggies that run to the characters and they will bombard them with questions about them, because I don't think they have ever seen humanoids before. Well, like, they are humanoids, but humans or human-like creatures before. And that Twig from before, let's call him Stickard. Stickard, he will be taken to the druid's hut, and because the druid doesn't live in a cavity in a tree. The druid lives in a hut, and the druid will tell the characters that he or she, or I don't think that the characters can tell the sex of the stick, but it looks old. It got gnarly like looking features and a long mossy beard made of moss. But he will tell them that he will speak to the characters after he had healed Stickard. And while they are waiting, they can go to the stick pub and sample some sap wine, and they can play with the children. The children have a game called, what's that called in English? It's a children's game where you lay out a bunch of sticks on the table, and then you take turns on picking out sticks without making other sticks move. I think it's called like Jack Straws or something. So the Twig children, they would like to play this game with the characters, or they can speak to the inhabitants of the Twiggleton, and the sticks will ask them questions about the flesh life. Yep. After a while, the druid would have an audience with the characters, and he will know exactly what kind of antidote that Alice was talking about in her research notes. He knows where the plant or fungus, fungi, is growing, and he got the knowledge to brew that antidote for the characters. But of course, because this is a game, He won't part with that information before the pieces help him with something.
Yeah.
I think that the problem will have to do about the toads, colony of toads that are terrorizing Twiggleton. Okay, so there has been an increase of attacks and onslaughts from these toads, let's call them toaders, and the Twiggies aren't able to fight back, so that's why they're asking for help. So the druid wants them to like exterminate the toads, and he will of course offer them both the information and that he will brew the antidote, but he will also say that he will offer them any potions they want from his pantry. We have a bit of a problem here because the characters can't use direct violence. They can only defend themselves. Let's say that we have two options, just in case if the characters doesn't come up with their own plan. The first one would be a way to kill them without using direct violence, and the other one would be to not fight at all, a more diplomatic route. So let them ask around in town to gather information, to ask where the toaders live and what kind of creatures they are. I think that they live in a swamp. Well, the entire island is a kind of a swamp, but in the toaders' swamp, there is a pocket of natural gas. So it's really bubbly and foul smelling. And if the characters are able to ignite that gas, well, then the problem is solved. I think that they can meet a really fanatic Twiggy, a general type of person, or a religious Twig, and she will volunteer to be set on fire and to run into the swamp and hopefully ignite the gas bubbles. But I don't think that's enough, so the characters still need to figure out a way to kill them without killing them, maybe using traps, or so they would need to scout the area and really plan this mission. But the toaders themselves, they aren't buff or strong or anything like that. They will die from the slightest hit, but of course the characters can't hit them, so they will need to find a way. However, if the characters would like to go the more diplomatic route, they will need to go to the swamp and talk to them. And there, they will get a completely different story from the toaders' point of view. Oh, let's make the Twiggies bad guys in the story. It's so obvious, I don't know why I didn't think about that. A fun thing is if maybe the Twiggies eat their offspring, not the Twig offspring. How does even Twigs reproduce? Doesn't matter. But they eat the toaders' eggs, but they don't know that. The toaders lay their eggs in a foam that builds up around puddles. The Twiggies eat that foam, so they doesn't know that they're eating toad eggs. Yeah, so the toaders are just defending themselves because they are about to go extinct. So the characters walk into the swamp and they can speak to the toad chieftain. Let's call her Priscilla. And when they hear this story, they will probably want to solve this conundrum in a more peaceful way. There are unlimited possibilities there to what the characters can come up with, so just lean back and enjoy the ride. They will come up with the pure magic. It will be really fun. Okay, so when they're done with this mission, they will return to the druid and he will then tell them how to get hold of the antidote. So let's send the characters off to the last journey, and that will be the next video that will tie the entire story together. But we need to come up with what that will be. Where does the plant grow? But I don't think it's a plant. I think it's a fungus or fungi, or whatever it's called. Oh, I watched the TLC, the Learning Channel, when I visited my mom a couple of weeks ago. There I saw a show about a obese person, and he had fungus growing between the crevices of his belly flubber. And that's of course really tragic, but it's also extremely disgusting. Let's use that. The characters will need to get hold of the fungus that grows between the belly fat of a creature. And it's gonna be dangerous and they can't use violence, so they need to use their wit, which makes me think about a story about that boy who had a eating competition with a giant. I don't know if you have it in America or in wherever you are from, but I think it's a Grimm story, Brother Grimm. But let's introduce a entirely different breed of giants. Oh, have you know about Norway? They are pros when it comes to stories about giants. They have a breed of giants called Tusselad. It's a giant with two heads, and I think that it's where we will send the characters to. They will need to excavate fungus from giants. Their crevices. And there you go, that's the middle part of the story, and the next video we will resolve this entire adventure and we will have a complete adventure in front of us. I think this adventure has the possibility to become a really memorable adventure within your playing group. Just tell me down below in the comments how you would take this adventure and how you would end it, how you would tie the knot together, so to say. Remember to hit the like button and the subscribe button and the belly button so you will get notified when the last episode comes out. And remember that when you push the like button, this video will be shown to people, like-minded people such as yourself and me, that like this kind of content. So let's help them find this video, don't you think? I really enjoyed coming up with the middle part of the story together with you. Thank you for watching. See you next time. I'm Glen Coco. You're freaking awesome.